morning. Welcome. It's good to see you all here this morning. It's a beautiful morning. We get to sit in here and worship the Lord and enjoy each other's company while the Lord takes care of us out there with the rain, and so we're thankful for that. We've needed it, and so it's a lovely thing. So we're thankful for it. All right, let's transition into the worship of our Lord this morning. We're gonna work our way through the 118th Psalm, and so we're gonna do that together. Particularly at first here, we're gonna do this antiphonally, which means I'm gonna say a line, you're gonna say a line. So would you stand with me as we work through this? And I invite Clark and the band to come up, and we're gonna move from the call to worship right into singing songs to our Lord Jesus Christ. So here's the first four verses of Psalm 118. You can help me out with this. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Let Israel say,
his steadfast love endures forever.
Let the house of Aaron say,
his steadfast love endures forever.
Let those who fear the Lord say,
his steadfast love endures forever.
Wonderful.
Yes, and we sing of this same thing. It's like a burning fire that we can't keep inside. We have to let it out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Keep from singing your praise.
Pray with me. Indeed, Almighty God, we are singing out to you as an outpouring of the joy that you have put in our hearts. Indeed, that this is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, not because mere circumstances, but because you are faithful and because you are true. And whether there be troubled times or storms that assail us, or whether we find our day in the sun, Lord, you are the God who is over all, and you are not unaware, and all things are from your hand. And we give you glory, and we give you praise, and we humble ourselves before you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Psalm 118 continues this way. Out of my distress, I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me free. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? The Lord is on my side. As my helper, I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. That's great. That'd make a great Facebook status, right? Put that in your bio, right? I shall triumph over those who hate me. I love it. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. And it's true. This is the word of God. Would you stand again? And we're going to sing some more.
Yes, indeed, let us not fear man, but fear the one who has told every lightning bolt where it should go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Told every lightning bolt where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow. Who imagined the sun and gave source to its light? It conceals it to bring us the coolness of. None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. Uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God.
Yes, Lord. You may be seated.
I love that the Bible recognizes that we face challenges and difficulties and even enemies that are too great for us. Things that we can't overcome by ourselves. And Psalm 118 recognizes that. We continue reading our way through with verses 10 through 13. Verse 10, I've never seen this on a coffee cup. Someday I will, and it's going to be great. Because this is a great verse. All nations surrounded me. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. Isn't that great? They surrounded me on every side. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me like bees. They went out like a fire among thorns. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. I was pushed hard so that I was falling, but the Lord helped me. Have you ever been there? If you haven't, you will be. And you will be pushed hard and you will be falling. And you cry out to the Lord and he will help. He really will. We're thankful. And I want you to join me in sort of echoing that prayer by praying the Lord's Prayer with me, would you? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
Going to take our Bibles and turn to Esther chapter 8. Sandy this morning said, man, we are just zooming through Esther. We are going so fast. But she's the teacher who starts off at the beginning of the year to teach first year confirmation students, right? And that's the Old Testament stuff. And by the end of the year, she's made it all the way up to like Joshua or something like that, you know. So anyway, Sandy doesn't leave anything out. Everything gets put in there. Esther chapter 8. We have sermon notes up here that cook along. Actually, those are, for those of you who are visiting, initially those were confirmation things. I would have my confirmation students fill them out, but people like them, and so we keep doing that. But it kind of helps you to, If you cannot make heads or tails out of anything I'm saying, this is a second shot at it, you know, to figure out what in the world is Bob talking about, and hopefully it'll make some kind of logical sense to you, and you can fill in the blanks if you'd like to. If it doesn't help you, don't fuss with them at all. You know, when it's a different thing these days being a believer in Jesus Christ than it used to be. You know, when I was a younger guy, and I said, I've become a believer, everybody was excited and happy about that. People in the church, certainly, but even people outside the church. And when I said, well, I'm thinking about becoming a pastor, oh, yes, that was wonderful. And we approve, and it was very noble and honorable. And even if my friends didn't really believe all that stuff, they still were happy. They were happy for me, you know. They were excited that I was doing that, and this was a good and positive thing. But now, to be a believer in Christ, to be a good, sound, apostolic church as in the world is seen as a, you're a bad guy. You're a bad guy if you believe. Everything that I believed when I became a Christian back in, way back there, everything that was part and parcel of my life, those things were all seen as positives. We haven't changed. Everything is exactly the same. But now we are kind of the bad guy. We are looked down upon. You ever notice that? Everybody is mad at us. If you're a conservative church, if you're a conservative believer, if you hold to all the ancient apostolic biblical truths and to hold them with the emphasis and in the way that the apostles taught them and did them, if you do that, more often than not, you will be a bad guy in the setting that you're at. The government seems to be mad at us. The medical people seem to be mad at us. Political activists are mad at us. The university is mad at us. Hollywood is mad at us. Silicon Valley is mad at us. Facebook would like to grab us by the TikTok and tweet us an Instagram, a once and for all thing that leaves us saying, "What's up with that?" You know, that's kind of how we feel. They would just like to just cancel us right out of existence because we are bad guys. For people who kind of feel under the gun these days, for people who feel attacked these days, who feel like everybody is making us out to be the bad guy, Esther 8, I think, is a good passage for us, a helpful passage for us as we look at this. Watch what happens. God's deliverance came. Joe told us about that last week. Haman, the bad guy, the one who was out to cancel the Jews, he has been put to death. And we even had the Ding Dong, the Witch is Dead song. By the way, we got busted for that. Did you know that? We tried to put that up on Facebook, and they canceled us on that. That's a copyright violation there. So anyway, we were out, so we couldn't do that, I guess. But at any rate, so we're rejoicing in that. But you might think, well, that's the end of the story. That would be the perfect ending of the story. We're saved. Everything is wonderful. But as you know, it doesn't always work that slickly or easily. And so here we come now into, there is another chapter, chapter 8, and notice what happens. There's good fallout for the people of God. In chapter 8, verse 1 and 2, it says, "On that day, King Ahasuerus gave to Queen Esther the house of Haman, the enemy of the Jews, and Mordecai came before the king, for Esther had told what he was to her, and the king took off his signet ring, which he had taken from Haman, and gave it to Mordecai, and Esther set Mordecai over the house of Haman." And so here you see that just very quickly, as a consequence now, the people of God who had been threatened, who were about to be destroyed, instead Esther is given property, the property of her enemy, and Mordecai is given the position of the enemy, the position that Haman held in the kingdom of Persia. Mordecai now holds that position. So this is their reward. If you look at verse 3, we notice something interesting. Verse 3, "Then Esther spoke again to the king. She fell at his feet and wept and pleaded with him to avert the evil plan of Haman the Agagite and the plot that he had devised against the Jews." And so here we discover that even though Haman is dead, his plot is still in the mix. And so she says, "King, please do something about this order to kill the Jews." You remember how that worked? They had set aside a day when all the Jews would be destroyed in the kingdom of Persia, and they picked by lot the date, and it turned out to be like a year from then. Remember December 13th or something like that? And so they had this problem, and so the order to kill all the Jews, that you can't undo that. Once a law has been made, the law has been made, and so Esther is coming and saying, what can we do? And so as you kind of read forward in verses 4 and following, the king held out the scepter, and she was received, and she made her request, and she says, if I am pleasing in his eyes, let an order be written to evoke the letters devised by Haman the Agagite, the son of Hammedatha, which he wrote to destroy the Jews. For how can I bear, verse 6, how can I bear to see the calamity that has come to my people? And then verse 7, the king said to Queen Esther and to Mordecai, behold, I've given Esther the house of Haman, and they've hanged him on the gallows, because he intended to lay hands on the Jews. But verse 8, but you may write as you please with regard to the Jews in the name of the king, and seal it with the king's ring, for an edict written in the name of the king, sealed with the king's ring, cannot be revoked. And so the scribes in verse 9 were summoned at that time in the third month, which is the month of Sivan, and the 23rd day, and an edict was written according to all that Mordecai commanded concerning the Jews to the satraps and the governors and the officials of the provinces from India to Ethiopia, 127 provinces, to each province in its own script and to each people in its own language, and also in the Jews in their language. And he wrote in the name of the king and so forth and sent it out. And the whole gist of that, as we read on, is that, well, we can't undo this edict that all the Jews should be killed, but we are going to give a counter edict that the Jews can defend themselves, that the Jews can defend themselves against this edict. They can go ahead and arm themselves, and they can do battle with anybody that tries to enforce this rule. And this really didn't involve everybody in the whole kingdom, I don't think, because not everybody was on board with that edict. But the enemies, the people who were against the Jews, the ones who were going to do the attacking, they were going to be in the crosshairs of the Jewish people as they were given permission to do that. And so, as we read through in verse 10, for instance, we see that he wrote in the name of the king and sealed it, and then he sent letters by mounted couriers riding on swift horses. And so they sent this email out, Pony Express style. If you jump down to verse 14, the end of that paragraph, you'll see, so the couriers mounted on their swift horses that were used for the king's service, and they rode out hurriedly, urged by the king's command. And so there's this emergency mailing by Pony Express that goes out from India to Ethiopia. That covers a lot of area, and then north up into the area of the Persian Empire as well, and so forth. So having received now this edict that these Jews can defend themselves, what happens? Look at verse 16. In verse 16 it says, the Jews had light and gladness and joy and honor. Kind of get the feel for that. Kind of feel the flavor of that. The Jews had light and honor and so forth. As we read that, notice the flavor of the atmosphere. Nothing had happened yet. Nothing had really taken place. Nobody had tried to kill the Jews yet, and they had not had to defend themselves yet, but that was coming. But simply knowing, simply understanding that this is what they could do, that they could have hope that they were not just going to be able to or have to stand off to the side and be attacked and be killed. There was a new hope. And I like how these four little virtues put in there. The Jews had light and gladness and joy and honor. A new spirit entered into the people. You and I, we need that kind of spirit, don't we? In our world, which feels like most people are mad at us and don't like us for what we stand for or what we hold to, you can kind of get to feel bad. You can kind of get to feeling like, wow, everybody hates me, nobody likes me, think I'll go eat worms. That's a little ditty from Sandy's childhood. And not that she had a bad childhood, but. There was a new spirit, a new heart within people. It just, you just kind of felt differently. You just felt like, oh, there's hope. Oh, there's possibilities. All is not lost. Yes, something is happening, and it's good and powerful. As we've come through this past year, it has just been one negative piece of news upon the other, and things have seemed to have gotten worse and worse, and that just kind of builds on a people. That kind of becomes the national identity, becomes the spirit of the realm. And we need for God to come and give us light and joy and peace and honor. We need a new spirit within our hearts. Here we see it coming for them. In verse 17, it's interesting, and in every province and in every city, wherever the king's command and his edict reached, there was gladness and joy among the Jews, a feast and a holiday. They're having a party over it. And many from the peoples of the country declared themselves Jews, for fear of the Jews had fallen on them. So the Jews had just been given permission and a sword to go out and kill anybody that tried to kill them. And so all of a sudden, everybody sits around going, hey, I can see where this is going. Are you Jewish? I'm Jewish. The Septuagint, which is the Greek version of the Old Testament, so the Old Testament written later on, translated into Greek, they added something to this little verse. What do you think they added? And some of them circumcised themselves. That's how serious this was. And so I'm not going to say that was in the Bible because they added that, but it just kind of tells you the flavor, right? Kind of gives you the idea. It's like there was a huge, like, yep, I'm a Jew, you're a Jew, we're all Jews, you know, because nobody wanted to get on the wrong end of the stick, literally, on that one. So this is the story now. This is the picture in Esther chapter 8, the basics of it. Let's talk about the lesson. What do we learn? What do we see from this? We've already talked a little bit about that new spirit, but let's talk about something broader. There is an ancient hatred of God's people in the world. There is this ancient hatred. People do not like God's people. Did you notice that Haman is called, hope I'm saying that right, an Agagite? How do you say that? Agagite? What is an Agagite? Well, obviously, that's somebody who goes around finding agates. Right? What else could it be? No, it's not somebody looking for agates. An Agagite is an interesting being because Haman is called an Agagite. You know, you see it back up here in, Sandy, can you find the verse for me? Verse 8. If you look in verse 3, then Esther spoke to the king. She fell at his feet, pleaded with him to avert the evil plan of Haman, the Agagite. Haman is called an Agagite. What is that? Esther chapter 3, verse 10 also has it. So the king took his signet ring from his hand and gave it to Haman, the Agagite, the son of Hammedatha, the enemy of the Jews. That was back in chapter 3, verse 10. So Haman is called this Agagite. Well, Agag as it turns out in the Bible, was a king from the many years past. And this king, Agag, was king over the people called the Amalekites. The Amalekites. Now, this is actually kind of significant. The Amalekites were ancient enemies of God's people. When God, through Moses, busted Israel out of Egypt, brought them into the wilderness, and they were marching to the promised land, and they had a little detour of 40 years, but then they got back going again. And they are coming, and in order to get to the promised land, they had to go through Amalekite territory. And they sent people to the Amalekite leaders, Moses did, and said, dude, we just want to get from here to there. We're just going to pass through your land. We're not going to take anything. We're not going to touch anything. We're not going to eat any of your food. We're just going to cruise right through there. Okay? And the Amalekites said, shoot, no. No. We hate you guys. We are not going to let you pass through our land. Don't even try it, or we'll come against you armed for war. And so there is this, why was that there? They hadn't even met before. The Amalekites had never even run into the Israelites, as far as we know, that much. Maybe there was some kind of ancient thing, but the point is, there was no animosity there other than just this natural, we looked at those guys and we do not like them. We don't like the way you look. We don't like the way you smell. We don't like the way you are. Go away. Get out of here. Agag was the king of those guys. Saul, the first king of Israel, remember Saul? The first king of Israel, God said, Saul, go and attack those Amalekites and destroy them and make sure you destroy the king, Agag, and don't take any of their plunder. Well, Saul won the battle with God's help, but he kept some of the plunder and he kept Agag alive. And for that disobedience, God took the kingdom away from Saul. He said, I reject you as being king. I'm going to bring somebody else who is somebody after my own heart, somebody who will obey me. And so this is an Agagite. An Agagite is a descendant of the king of the Amalekites, somebody who has a natural hatred for God's people. But you know what? This probably goes even deeper than this. Because way back at the beginning of things, in the book of Genesis, chapter 3, God is, Adam and Eve have sinned now. They have sinned against God. They ate the fruit they shouldn't have eaten. And they have broken the universe. Right? They took the universe out for a spin, and they crashed. And now the universe is going to be limping along with a leaky radiator and tranny fluid coming out, and you're out of alignment in the front, and your tires are wearing out, and your radio doesn't work right. That's the universe that we're in. The beautiful, amazing universe that God created now has all kinds of problems in it. And so God is dealing with Adam and Eve, but first he deals with Satan, and he says to Satan, the serpent, I will put enmity. What's enmity? Enmity is like just kind of a natural hatred, a natural conflict. It's like, you know, any of you larger families, brothers and sisters, you know how they kind of just love to fight with each other? That's enmity. They just love to fight. They're always against each other, always angry with each other. There's a bitterness that's built in them towards each other. It says, I will put enmity between you, serpent or Satan, and the woman, and between your offspring, Satan, and her offspring, that you and I, and more specifically down to Jesus, and he will bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. So that's this prophecy and this prediction and this new situation, that there is a natural hatred between Satan and the powers of evil and the seed of the woman through Jesus, her eventual descendant, who is the head of God's people. There is an ancient hatred of God's people spurred on by the spiritual powers of evil and Satan himself. Why is there this animosity towards God's people? There are spiritual beings that are pushing it. But the beautiful truth here in the book of Esther is that God is at work to preserve his people. That's the next lesson. Even though there's a natural hatred in this world, God is at work to preserve his people. In the Old Testament, we have one long story of how God's steadfast love has gone out to protect and preserve his own people. Sometimes only a remnant, but always some. And when Jesus arrives on the scene, he even takes that further when he says, Matthew 16, verse 18, "And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." See, the gates of hell are trying to prevail against the church, but Jesus said they will not win. And finally, the book of Revelation shows us the end of it all. Revelation 12, verse 10, for instance, "Now the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brothers has been thrown down, who accuses them night and day before God." You see, that ancient enemy, just like Haman was destroyed, so our enemy, Satan, is going to be cast down and utterly defeated. God is at work saving and preserving his people. There are casualties in this war at times, no doubt about it. But God ultimately is going to bring this. And the third lesson is this. This knowledge, just knowing this, even if it hasn't happened yet, just knowing this brings peace and joy and light and honor to God's people right now. Though our salvation has not yet been completely accomplished, yet still we are filled with joy. Yes, God is at work. As Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 6 to 7, "In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." So you see, we're in it. We have to go through trials now. Things can be difficult. There are some casualties. But nevertheless, no one is ever left behind. God is at work to make our faith stronger and more true and more solid in him. All right, so let's do, those are our lessons. Let's try to make just a very quick application and then we're done, okay? Application, point number one, our enemy has been defeated. Yes, Haman is dead. Satan is cast down. But His policies remain and are still used against us. And so, we are forced to defend ourselves as best we can until our deliverance is made complete when our Savior returns at the end of the age. But for now, we have light and gladness, joy and honor, knowing that if God be for us, who can be against us? That's the message of Esther chapter 8. It's a frightening thing to be outside of the protective providence of God's hand. It's a frightening thing to be alone, all by yourself, in this kind of world. Are you feeling, how would I say it? Have you come under God's protection? Have you given your life to Jesus Christ completely and fully so that now you can say, I belong to Him? And no matter what happens to me in this life, no matter what enemy comes against me, I am in God's hand and in God's protection. That truth comes to those who put their faith in Jesus Christ, who trust in what Jesus has done to cleanse us and to reunite us to this wonderful God who is our providential Savior in every way that we need to be saved. If you are one today who has not done that, or you're not sure, if you have not surrendered, if you have not given your life to Christ, you can do it right now. You can believe, you can trust, you can give yourself to Him, and He welcomes you with open arms, and now you are part of this amazing body that's called the people of God. And sure, you're going to inherit some enemies, but you had them anyway. Let's give our hearts anew to Christ. Let's pray. Father, You are an amazing God, indescribable, unchangeable. All things are in Your hand, and we rejoice to join that number and say we want to be in Your hand too. Even now, as we lift our hearts up to You, Lord, in prayer, we open our beings to You and we invite You. Come in new and fresh. Come in and cleanse us from our sin and receive us unto Yourself. Fill us with Your Holy Spirit. Quicken us to be made part of Your people. And continue, O Lord, to help us trust in Your salvation for all that we need in this world, for all that comes against us. For somebody here today that is especially under the gun in the battle, we pray, grant unto them a salvation, a deliverance. Give them courage and strength. And we pray that You would just increase their commitment to You, even as the pressure increases on them to turn away from You. Father, we thank You and we praise You for filling us with peace and light and joy and honor. Even now, we look forward to the day when Your salvation will be made complete. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much, Pastor Bob. You remember the message of the book of Ecclesiastes is, and I have this on a t-shirt actually, life is difficult and then you die. You remember that? Which is true. But Esther reminds us that for the people of God, life is difficult, but God cares and is at work and works things out. All right. let me encourage you to stick around and grab some coffee. We have the best coffee ever. Not because it's, I mean, it's Folgers, but it's made with love, and it's just great. So let me encourage you to stick around, grab some coffee. There will be some cookies and stuff. Young men, if you wouldn't mind setting up 3 or 4 tables up here, that'd be great. Chance to something to sit around, set our coffee on, and that would be wonderful. All right. As we prepare to go with the benediction. I'll just take this from Esther 8, all right? Go with light and gladness and joy and honor from our Lord Jesus Christ, to whom be dominion now and forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Amen and amen. Let's sing the doxology.
Praise God.
You are dismissed.